Wouldn't it be great if we could take the surplus of CO2 out of the air and never worry about it again? Or even better, recycling it and using it as a fuel source? Let me tell you that it's not science fiction, but real science.
Can you take CO2 out of the atmosphere? Vanuit Huis van het Hout in Etterbeek. Dit is de Universiteit van Vlaanderen.
Among the news of pandemic, there was another news item. I'm talking about global warming and its root cause, increasing CO2 concentrations in our atmosphere. And this is a big fight, but we have several tools in our hand. I'm going to talk about one of these tools this evening. It's called CCUS, carbon capture, utilization, and storage. But before talking about CCUS, why do we have so much CO2 in the air? To understand this better, we have to delve deeper into how energy flows around us. To our planet, there is only one inflow of energy, which is from our star, Sun. We cannot harvest this energy directly. We have plants and microorganisms around us that can harvest this energy and turn it into a common currency of chemical energy, which is called hydrocarbons. This stores, this molecule consists of carbon and hydrogen, and they are unstable bonds. They are not happy together. In the presence of oxygen, they gladly would break their bond, bond with oxygen, and release a significant amount of heat energy. This is the energy that we use in our bodies, in our everyday lives, but there is not enough hydrocarbon around us to drive complete industrial revolution or put us in a plane, 300 people at a time, non-stop flights halfway around the world. There is not enough hydrocarbon to do that. So we actually tapped literally into the mother load of hydrocarbons, which is, I'm talking about oil and gas, of course. And oil and gas is also solar energy stored 100 million years ago underground. But when we buy this energy, we are not interested in carbon or hydrogen. We are interested in this bond that I talked to you about. I can prove you that. Just look at your exhaust pipe in a cold morning. If white fume is flowing out, that's water. Because when hydrocarbons, the hydrogen, is reacting, is burning, it becomes two hydrogen and one oxygen merge, it becomes water. There is another gas which is coming out there, which is invisible to our naked eye, and that's CO2, which is carbon dioxide breaking its bonds and bonding with two oxygens, actually. So why is it dangerous? The problem is in this CO bond, carbon-oxygen bond, because this bond absorbs infrared light and releases heat. Now, I told you that the only energy flux was solar light, right? Well, around half of this solar energy that's delivered to Earth is in the form of infrared light. So if you have more of a molecule that can absorb infrared and heat up, that means during the day you will heat better, and the night side of the Earth will cool worse, because that's how we cool. That's how Earth cools down, by releasing its infrared into the space. But if there is something absorbing this release of infrared, it keeps its heat. So this creates a temperature surplus, and that's the main root cause of global warming. So how much carbon dioxide are we talking about in this very air we breathe? And all around the world, average roughly 0.75 gram of carbon dioxide exists every cubic meter. And this was the first target of the chemical engineering research and development, to capture directly this existing carbon from the air. Actually, the name is direct air capture. And this is the first carbon capture strategy. As we speak right now, there are different plants all around the world actively blowing the atmosphere through contact medium, which is wet with a special solvent that is selective only to carbon dioxide, and it takes, it reacts and takes the carbon dioxide from the air and leave the other gas molecules alone. This is like catching butterflies with your net. But this is not the only tool of carbon capture. There is a second method, a second strategy, if you will. This is exactly a very similar idea as direct air capture, but we do not use the standard atmosphere as our carbon source, but we go to the chimneys of big carbon-emitting plants, like power plants, for example, and we capture carbon directly from these point sources. And that's the name of the strategy. It's point source capture. The second strategy has an advantage over the first one because, as you can imagine, the carbon dioxide concentration is hundreds of times higher at this chimney rather than the very air we breathe. So it is cheaper to capture this carbon dioxide. And the cost of capture is very important. That's one of my research areas in KU Leuven, Campus Diepenbeek. We actually use aerosols, very fine mists, to capture carbon dioxide rather than contact towers. It's a new prototype we have. These are the two carbon capture strategies. And the International Energy Association estimates that 90% of carbon capture will be point source capture, and 10% of the overall carbon capture that we will do will be direct air capture. So we need both of these strategies. So what is the scale? Let's talk a little bit about money. As of now, 2022, we are capturing 14 million tons of CO2 from these different sources. This sounds big. It is big, 14 million tons, but it is nothing with respect to what it will become. In the upcoming decades, this capacity will increase 250 times and reaching more than 10 billion tons. So this is a non-existing heavy industry that will become one of the biggest industries in the world. Let's say we were successful, we actually captured 10 billion tons, we can capture cheaply 10 billion tons of carbon from point source, from air, fine. What are we going to do with it? We don't need so much carbon dioxide. 10 billion tons. We can't make 10 billion ton worth of tank every year. Within some years, the world will be covered with CO2 tanks. And here, we will go to storage. The first storage strategy, which is very abundant today, is applied today, is drilling the ground hundreds of meters below impermeable rock formations and injecting liquid carbon dioxide below these rock formations. And they stay there. They don't come back up because these rocks don't allow them back up. And secondly, over the years, they become rocks themselves. CO2. Done. We don't have to build new tanks. It's nice. But actually, this is a high pressure, high volume process. And in chemical engineering, we don't like these words. This means expensive. High pressure, high volume, we don't want. So we want some money out of it. Okay, I'm an engineer, not a pure scientist. I want some money out of it. And then the strategy of utilization comes. So storage and utilization. The first utilization strategy was, again, sending it underground, but actually helping it get more oil from me. So we don't inject it to any rock formation, but we inject it to our oil wells. And this goes to the nooks and crannies and below the porous rock formations which holds the oil like sponge, and it pushes the oil, this pressurized liquid pushes the oil back up, so I get more money per oil drill. This is called enhanced oil recovery. Enis, it's a little bit stupid because we want to get rid of carbon. Why are we using carbon to get more carbon out? You should understand that not all fossil is used for fuel. We also use it for fine chemicals, pharmaceuticals, polymers, textile. So chemical industry is beyond fuels. And we still need a stable source of hydrocarbons for these as these building blocks. So is this all? No. There is one final strategy that is not as much applied as EOR, enhanced oil recovery, which is carbon conversion. And it is very special for me because this is also within my research group. This works a little bit like rechargeable battery. So when we get the hydrocarbon and we use it, we burn it, we oxidize it, we use its energy, it becomes CO2. If we take the CO2, if we give it hydrogen, and if we give the heat that we took from it back, nothing happens. If we give more heat, if we heat it up, some of the hydrocarbons we can get back. There are, of course, you can understand there are some caveats here. Okay? First of all, we give it a lot of heat. It's not a good business proposition, because also we get some part of the hydrocarbons back. So there are a lot of researchers in Belgium, all around the world, that are trying to change this scenario. Catalyst researchers, they are trying to find new, better catalytic materials to actually reduce this energy that we have to give, and also change the selectivity towards getting more hydrocarbons. And there is also us. I am of the second type. Process intensification experts who are trying to team up with these catalyst professionals, researchers, and take their catalysts and start from a small lab scale equipment and scale it up efficiently to very high scales, industrial scales and heavy industrial scales. While doing so, we would like to incorporate also renewable energy sources, because we cannot just use hydrocarbon energy to recycle hydrocarbons, carbon dioxide. We need renewable energy sources and maybe even solar energy. And that's actually that specific thing, recycling carbon dioxide with solar energy, is called artificial photosynthesis. It's one of my research lines in Campus Diepenbeek. So what was the question? Can we take CO2 out of the atmosphere? Yes, we can. But as someone, and also we can recycle it even better, but as someone who is dedicating significant years of his research career to this line, I can already tell you that, as a plot twist, it's not going to save the world. Not alone. International Energy Agency estimates that only 1/4 of our carbon mitigation will be by CCUS. The other 75% will be energy transition, new technologies, and good leadership to promote and help us adapt these new way of life into ours.